welcome to Dale's DIY. New at this, but it's going to be a lot of fun as we work on this together. Starting with a build of a 1993 Ford Ranger. I want to put a V8 and an automatic in it because I do pull a trailer with it some, and there's some places I go where the hills are very steep, and a manual transmission with a trailer can be very problematic. And so I chose to do a 302 and a C4 automatic in this Ranger. Now the nice thing about the 1993 is it has a mechanical speedometer, so there will not be a problem in attaching the speedometer cable of the older style transmission. And so that is a nice added benefit. Now, with the C4 automatic, we had already taken it apart, and my son, Joel, he's a quick shout out to Fat Basses TV, P-H-A-T, Fat Basses TV. A lot of good fishing stuff on there. He said, "Dad, why don't you make a channel and show people how to do this stuff? You've been doing it for years." So I'm going to show you the stuff that I learned back when I was 20. We had a shop, me and two other friends. We did automatic transmissions. I learned it from a guy that actually was on the racing team that did the stock. I believe they were either runner-up or champions with the 1969 GTO Judge with the Ram Air 4. And he actually did transmissions for them. So anyway, that's who trained me. His name was Bob. And so I learned a few things, and I'm going to share those with you. Now, as you look at this, yes, it's been apart, cleaned it, put it back together. You never know what you're going to run into when you pull these things apart. The person, this has been rebuilt at least once, and whoever did it before I got it had used a lot of gasket glue, and so the front pump was really hard to take out. Don't use gasket glue except for the pan side of your transmission gasket. Otherwise, lots of troubles. Don't need it. So anyway, with that being said, as you work on these things, you know, work with what you got, see what somebody else has done. You may have to take some corrective measures. As you take the transmission apart, look for clues. This one had had a lot of heat. And as I got to looking, the check balls in the return circuit from the converter to the cooler were stuck. So there was no fluid going through the transmission cooler. So, you know, when you look at things, you see the symptoms of something's been hot, something's been worn, something's got metal shavings. Be aware and look for where the problems are. For me, the easiest place to start is to, you roll it over, and you will work on the transmission pan. And what we'll do is we will take the pan off, and then we'll take that valve body off, and that will kind of expose the rest of the transmission. Half inch bolts, and so I just get these, I've got it put on with two, so it won't take long. Now if I was really uptown, we would have an air wrench to do this, but that's the way life goes. Now the other thing, I like to label my containers. This one says valve body and pan, and that way we could keep all the bolts straight where they belong and where they go. So quick take this off. Now, after we take this off, a nice little table here built when I started doing transmissions. Now, we'll just kind of take a look here, and you'll see this valve body. This is a valve body inside the transmission pan. Now, the surprise that will get almost everybody every single time underneath here is a valve. And if you're not paying attention, and you take this off, you can lose that valve and your transmission will not go anywhere without it. The bolts that hold this valve body on are 3/8, and there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 of them. And we'll get into the valve body later when we put in a shift kit. Now, You don't have to go all wild with a shift kit. The Transgo has a very nice shift kit that will do a great job, and it doesn't cost a ton of money. So let's get the quarter-inch drive. It doesn't take a lot of force to get these things apart. One bolt there. And where did I put the other one? May have to get my glasses. Okay, my bad. The other one was in this corner over here. And that just goes to show sometimes, even when you've done it more than once, you can get yourself in a corner. I don't wear glasses often. I should wear them more often than I do. As you look at this and you take it apart, this is what they call the manual valve. And that little part right there goes into the little deal right here, and that pin runs this valve for neutral, reverse, drive, wherever it goes, called the manual valve, and it comes out here to that shaft that connects to your steering column. So that is how that goes, and then right there is the kickdown from your carburetor. You've got that rod that goes from the carburetor. It'll come through the valve over here, this angled valve, right here, this angled piece hits that valve. When you stomp on the gas, it pushes that kickdown valve. That increases line pressure so that you don't get slippage when it kicks into passing gear. Now, as we start to go further, make sure you put your lid on your bolts so you don't spill them. And then the next thing we're going to do is take this front pump out. Now you'll see that it normally has several bolts. This is a case fill transmission. We talk about pan fill and case fill. And in another video, I'm going to show you a lot of stuff about Fords because not everything is interchangeable. If you look over here, right there, it fills in the case. This has got a smaller bell housing and it fits in tighter places, such as the old Mustang or a Ranger pickup. The pan fill will fill into the pan right here, and it has a bigger bell housing. It's made for pickups, and the bolt pattern on the pan fill will actually be separate. There'll be bolts on the pump, and then there'll be bolts on the bell housing. This here, it shares bolts through the pump and then into through the bell housing into the pump and then into the case. Plenty good for any reasonable application. Some guys even put these behind 460s, run incredible amounts of horsepower through them. These bolts here are 9/16. And it doesn't take much. We'll just pop this bell housing off. Now, Ford bell housings, they come in several sizes. For this particular deal that we're working on, they come in a small bell housing of 157 tooth flywheel and a large bell housing of 164 tooth flywheel, which this is the large bell housing. And it takes a little bit larger converter for stock application. Of course, when you're working on a race car, which we are not, but in a race car, you can get whatever size torque converter you want. Now I'll find my front pump. I've got it labeled here. Put my bolts in there so I don't lose track of what I'm doing. And just a little quick push. Whoops. Lost my pump. Front pump come off with it, but that's not a big deal. All right. So what you have, I forgot to tell you, I personally take a center punch and mark where the pump goes. I put a little deal there and a little deal up here on this, on the top of my case. And so I can line everything up when I put it back together. But the center punch has just kind of got a little ground off bevel, and you can make a little dot there. So the C4 has an input shaft. that goes through the pump and into the front, and we'll show you that in a minute, that front hub. You'll see that there are two different sizes of length on these splines. Okay, the longer side goes into the torque converter. The shorter side, which also has, in some models, depending, Ford has three different kinds of shafts on the C4s I'm familiar with, and there may be options I don't know about. But anyway, this one has 24 teeth on this end, 26 on this end, and if I remember correctly, 1970 had 26 and 26, and previous to 1970 was a different spline count yet. So knowing what you have, making sure you don't mix your parts up, and like I say, one of these days I'll get my numbers together and we'll do a interchange of Ford products. You know, GM, I worked on a lot of GMs too. I did Pontiac, Chevrolet, a little bit of Oldsmobile, a little bit of Buick. There's a lot of good interchangeability. Their transmissions, other than the bow housings, are totally interchangeable in the performance years. So that's pretty straightforward. And of course, Buick, Pontiac, and Oldsmobile use the same bell housing, so engine adaptation and stuff was real easy. Chevrolet used the same bell housing. Some bell housings actually have a dual pattern, so you could trade motors around. And we did a lot of motor swaps back when I was young, and we had a lot of fun and made some pretty fast cars. So anyway, there's the shaft. So we'll put that to the side here, and then just kind of pop this, see if I can get that out without hurting my hand. I may have to get a hammer handle here. Okay, and I got that to where I can just kind of work that out now. Just kind of gently work it with the screwdriver once we got enough room with the hammer handle. And then you'll see the back of the bell housing. That has a real nice snug fit over the front of the pump. And then the seal goes here. You've got an input shaft bushing there. You'll have an input shaft bushing here. You have two different bushings on the front of the pump that set clearances. Now another thing, when we go back together, you'll have to make sure you get this bushing here right, or it will block oil flow and then you'll burn something up. So you have to pay attention to details. Let me set this down. So when we look at the front pump, we take it apart right quick, and these are just half inch bolts. Once again, I've already marked on here to match the little dot with my center punch so that when I go back together, I don't have to mess around. I just look for my little dots and away we go. Now, as we take this apart, there's five bolts, but I put it back together with two just so we can film it. So here's the spacer. And the spacer, they just slide off. They got little tabs that keep them in place. Then they have these grooves where snap rings go. We'll put new snap rings in when we put it back together, and those help seal the oil pressure in different areas where it mates together, which will be back in this area here. And we'll put these bolts and these spacers here with my front pump, there we go, the one I got marked pump. We'll put all that together, make sure we don't lose it, and we'll set this aside. Now on this part of the pump, this is the business end of the pump. Fluid is fed into here, it's brought around in these gears and pushed out. As the engine runs, you'll see these little flats here. This is the side that the torque converter lines up with. You can see those flats and then the bushing that the torque converter rides on. And we'll be replacing that bushing. That's a high wear area. That and the tail shaft bushings are always a good idea to replace. And then you just kind of look at the rest of the bushings and sealing surfaces, see how they work. Now, as you can see, you've got those flats. And then you've got a little bit different front to back. You got to make sure those flats are pointing towards the flats, and the relief go towards the torque converter, and this side goes towards the pump. I don't believe it makes any difference about if you've got these teeth timed. It'll work out no problem if you don't get it back exactly the same, as long as you get the downside where it belongs. And on the other gear, there's a little dot that keeps you lined up so that there's that dot. And you'll see that they're a little bit more beveled on this side and they're more flat on that side. So that's what you're looking for. We put it back together.